My name is Adam Lupel, IPI Vice President. Welcome to this policy forum, Preventing Mass Atrocities in an Era of Global Transition. This session has actually been in the works for quite some time. And in part, it stems from an early conversation between Naomi and myself, if you recall, I don't know, at least this is how I think of it, when she had just recently made the journey from New York's Global Center for the Responsibility to Protect to go down to Washington, D.C.'s U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum. And at that time, we lamented that far too often the conversations in D.C. And New York don't really connect, or they operate on parallel tracks. Surrounding the U.S. government down in D.C., we focus on UN here, when indeed there are many reasons to pursue connections, and I think especially on this topic. As many of you know, at IPI, we are just coming out of a two-year process of reviewing the UN system through the Independent Commission on Multilateralism, whose final report we launched over the high-level week. And one of the conclusions of the commission report, which dovetails with the findings of many others, is that in an era of global transition, in an era of globalization, there is greater need to pursue and enhance partnerships. And that holds for both for large institutions like the United Nations and the US government, and for smaller independent bodies like IPI. None of us can go it alone. And so I really want to thank our partners here at the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, especially Naomi Kikoler and Andrea Gittleman. Maybe next year in D.C., shall we say. I mentioned that this session has been in the works for quite some time, but that does not make it any less timely, sadly so. As the Global Center for R2P has pointed out, just this year in 2016, the UN has had to respond to four level three emergencies in Syria, Iraq, Yemen, and South Sudan. And in each of these situations, the risk of atrocities remain high. And the recent news out of Myanmar continues to be very troubling. In part, this reality of having to constantly respond to emergencies has inspired a renewed focus on issues of prevention. Issues of prevention, of course, have been at the heart of the UN work from the beginning, but they seem to come, interest seems to come and go. And this renewed focus is happening both at the UN Secretariat and I believe among member states. And this includes atrocity prevention, or at least it should. Along with a greater need, along with a need for greater commitments to partnerships, this need to put prevention into practice is another conclusion of the Independent Commission on Multilateralism that echoes, I think, a broad consensus. But how? Everybody likes to speak in favor of prevention, but debates often get muddy when specifics are involved. In this case, how do you implement policies to effectively prevent war crimes, crimes against humanity, ethnic cleansing, and genocide? In part, the next Secretary General, whom we can now call by name, will be judged by how he answers this question. And I think this, in this moment, should crystallize the need for both strategic thinking and focused action. And well, this is our modest goal to contribute to some of this thinking today. Some of the questions that we've had posed before us include how mass atrocities have evolved in recent years. For example, how does the rise of extremist non-state actors impact the context in which both atrocities occur and in which we must respond and develop prevention policies? What are the key challenges that face global policymakers who seek to prevent mass atrocities? And again, thinking of partnerships, how can the United Nations work with the United States and other actors to reinforce policy efforts to prevent and to respond to mass atrocities. We have two great panelists here to discuss these and other questions. You have their complete bios in your handouts. Unfortunately, Ambassador Jean-Darc Biagé, Deputy Permanent Representative of Rwanda to the United Nations, who was originally on the program, had to travel unexpectedly and so sends her regrets. She won't be able to join us today. But we do have Naomi Kikoler, Deputy Director of the Simon Scott Center for the Prevention of Genocide at the US Holocaust Memorial Museum, and Scott Strauss, Professor of Political Science and International Studies at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And it's a welcome back to both of you. Both consider any friends of IPI and have been here before. And so, welcome back. We will start with Professor Strauss, who will present elements of his new book, published by the museum, on fundamentals of genocide and mass atrocity prevention. I believe there were some copies around before, yeah. And then we'll turn to Naomi for further comments. With that, I will turn the floor to you, Scott.
So thanks so much, Adam, and to the IPI more generally for the hospitality, for the invitation. Thank you so much for coming to this event. I really appreciate you being here. I'm going to speak, I think, for 15-ish minutes, and the core of my presentation is going to be to present some of the main parts of this book and some of the core findings of the book, and then transition a little bit to the question of the coming agenda for mass atrocity prevention as the UN transitions and other places transition as well. So this particular book is a response to a perceived need for a short, comprehensive and updated overview of the field of atrocity prevention, a book that weaves together not only questions of the history of atrocity prevention, where did this idea come from, starting World War II, and questions of the causation, or why these types of events happen, but also to the question of prevention. That is something that weaves together all of these different elements. In our working lingo, it's a one-stop shop book that is synthetic, and that has a single authorial voice running through it to make it more accessible. The impetus came from two complementary directions. On the one hand, in DC, in Washington, there was the creation of something called the Atrocity Prevention Board, and a recommendation from that board in particular that there be a kind of training across different agencies on questions of atrocity prevention. And on the other hand, I think there's been a growing interest in atrocity prevention within the United Nations, the creation of specialized agencies within the United Nations, as well as the broader NGO community, not only here in New York, but globally, as well as a kind of general interest among among citizens, among students, and a wider variety of folks. However, I think there was a sense that the available training and education on these issues was both thin and diffuse. Diffuse in the sense that it was scattered across a lot of different articles and books and so forth. So the book really emerged from these needs, and I think these are the two main audiences for this book. Now, in developing the book, I took it as my task to wade into the existing literature on atrocities and atrocity prevention, summarize it, make it accessible, sort of translate the, you know, both what we knew from policy and from the academy, but also analyze it. And I'll come back to this in a little bit, but the book really aims to speak not only to the two audiences that I just mentioned, but also to different actors within those constituencies. In particular, those who are new to the topic of atrocity prevention, they could pick up this book and have access quickly to what this field is about, but also to people who are already engaged on the, whether practitioners, whether scholars, et cetera, but who wanted to learn more or wanted to have a slightly deeper dive on some of the scholarship or what have you. So the book is aiming, and you'll be the judge as to whether or not successfully, to straddle between these two audiences, between those who are more introductory readers and practitioners, as well as those who have some experience in the field. And I think that approach is doable in the sense that a lot of this field, and Adam and I were talking about this earlier, tends to be fairly compartmentalized, right? There are people who work on human rights, people who work on post-conflict peace building, people who work on the causes or forecasting of atrocities, and so forth. But I think, you know, or international law, whatever dimension you have, but a synthetic book that brings these things together, I think, was lacking. Quick work on the involvement of the museum, and perhaps Naomi will say more, but the museum shepherded the project, put together an advisory committee composed of people in the academic community, in the NGO community, in the UN community, and the government community. And I think the museum's involvement, I think, number one, came from desire to educate on questions of Holocaust, the questions of the Holocaust, of which we have a legacy here, as well as to advocate on questions of contemporary genocide. For my part, I see this as part of an effort. Adam talked earlier about partnerships. I see this as an effort to partnership between the academy, where I'm based, and you know, which is my home, and the public policy world. And I, you know, I you know, working in this field, I think it's an important priority to have those kinds of exchanges, both to translate what and make accessible what we're doing in the academy, but also to learn from people who are working in the public policy field to make our work better. So with that said, let me provide a kind of overview of the book's contents. There are six sections in the book. First is a kind of history of atrocity prevention, and the basic idea is to kind of walk through where we came from, World War I, World War II, through the Cold War into the contemporary period. Second, there's a section on concepts and definitions, which continue to plague this area. You know, what is genocide? Why have people moved away from genocide as the unifying concept? What is a mass atrocity? How does the concept of mass atrocity fit with international law? What are the core elements of a mass atrocity? Third, then there's a section on causes. This is a longer section, and there are three main chapters here. One is kind of a macro level take on the state of the art on risk factors and forecasting. Then a section on triggers and short-term kind of drivers of atrocities. And lastly, a chapter on perpetrators, who commits this violence and why. Then I think a longer section, probably of most interest to the practitioners in the room and to others, on prevention, composed of four chapters. And it goes from very general questions like, what is the difference between atrocity prevention and conflict prevention? And things like, what is the responsibility to protect? And what are the different pillars of responsibility to protect? But I think through a much more extended, or many of you might find more interesting, a more extended discussion of, you know, what are the concrete tools for atrocity prevention? How do these tools work together? What is the state of research on what we know about what works and what does not work among the range of tools that we have? Who are the key actors? How do they work together or not work together in partnership or the absence of partnership? And then there's a section, the fifth section is on the aftermath. What are the challenges, specific challenges of rebuilding states and societies after atrocity? What's the role of justice and what are the different mechanisms? What do we know about what the effects of these justice mechanisms are? And lastly, there's a section that looks forward to how atrocities might be changing and how the prevention space might be changing. Now, just a quick word on how it's written. Again, designed to be accessible, but it's also designed to foster a critical kind of strategic approach to this issue. And so rather than just being a textbook that summarizes what the field is, the book analyzes the literature, trying to pay attention to what we know and what we don't know, or contradictions in the findings of what we have. And so I think the book is both summarizing and bringing to a head where we've been and what we know, but also trying to set an agenda for areas for future work and future involvement. And I think the book doesn't shy away from, you know, deliberately doesn't shy away from the problems in this area, which we might talk about in discussion. And so again, the text is introductory, but also designed to reach knowledgeable readers. Okay, let me talk a little bit about some of the core findings of the book. And I'll summarize these, and these are subject to discussion. So first of all, while of course there is a long way to go, and while of course we are hit over the head every day now by Syria, by South Sudan and other places, and of course feel incredibly discouraged, I think it's crucial to recognize that there has been substantial progress in the area of atrocity prevention over the last two decades. In my view, compared to the early and mid-1990s, we have a considerably thicker, stronger anti-atrocity regime. And again, despite obvious challenges and shortcomings in places like Syria, I see progress. For one, I think the norm of atrocity prevention is stronger. Atrocity prevention is on the agenda, part of the policy conversation, internationally and domestically in various countries. I think atrocity prevention as a general policy priority has more visibility and more legitimacy, certainly than it did 20 years ago. And I think this is true both for policymakers and practitioners, but also for ordinary citizens and civil society actors. In short, I think the conversation is very different. And I think that's because of a kind of norm entrenchment in this area over the last two decades. Second, and relatedly, I think the policy frameworks are clearer. If you look back at the 1990s, you essentially see a pattern of ad hoc responses without a coherent policy framework to orient decision making. Excuse me. I'm not saying that the contemporary situation is perfect or coherent from an atrocity prevention point of view, but today I think you have a clearer sense of what atrocity prevention means, about how to square atrocity prevention with questions of sovereignty protections, and also a clearer sense that atrocity prevention should be part of the policy conversation, as I noted before. This does not mean that strategic, security, political, or other concerns do not enter the decision-making process. Of course, they do. But that atrocity prevention is part of the consideration in a more straightforward and more coherent fashion than it had been. Third, I think there have been important institutional developments. Here at the UN, you have the UN offices, the special advisors on genocide prevention, and the special advisor on responsibility to protect. You have, I think, a flourishing of special rapporteurs and commissions of inquiry on topics related to atrocity prevention. You have a significant rise of criminal justice mechanisms, both internationally and to a certain degree domestically. You have greater military training and planning tools in a number of countries. You have smarter, I think, intelligence assessments or the incorporation of atrocity risks into intelligence assessments. On the academic side, you have stronger, and the museum side, stronger forecasting models. And you have various domestic initiatives, such as the Atrocity Prevention Board and other things in other countries. So I think there have been important institutional developments. Fourth, I think the policy tools, the tool, I don't like the term toolkit, but the available options, I think, are more sophisticated and have been expanded considerably. Whereas at the start of this policy conversation in the 1990s, it was really, I think, a binary choice, like you intervene militarily or you don't. You know, you send in peacekeepers against the wishes of a state or you don't. I think today the conversation is much wider. There's a much wider range of tools, a number of non-coercive tools. There remain, I think, critical questions about what works, what's effective, and when, and under what conditions. But I think the conversation is no longer like send in the troops or don't send in the troops. I think it's a much more sophisticated conversation around tools. And lastly, I think the conceptual language is much better than it used to be. And that the move away from genocide as the unifying framework for thinking about this problem to the question of atrocity, I think has been a substantial improvement. Now, you may all take that for granted, but as I was sitting to look down and write this book and take stock of where we are in this field, I was really quite impressed, and I tend to be skeptical by nature. I was really quite impressed at how much had changed since I had started working on this and started working on the Rwandan genocide 20 years ago to where we are today in this conversation. A second, I think, core or broad finding is, I think at the same time, you know, the field is very young. Okay, there is a lot that we don't know and we don't understand. On the one hand, there has been this proliferation of tools and measures, but in terms of systematic evaluation of what works and when and so forth, I think that there is a lot of room for growth. And here I put a plug to those practitioners in the room that, you know, try to take stock of what your expectations are about what the effect, the intended effect of a particular measure is supposed to be, and assess at the end or sometime later, what was the effect and why? Why did it have the effect that it did? I think that kind of systematic analysis of the tools we have is a big next step, I think, for developing this field. Third big finding is, I think, that, you know, there's, I think, a recognition this is hard work. You know, I mean, when it was the conversation in the 1990s, it was really just a question of political will and the absence of political will when dealing with Rwanda, Bosnia, or what have you. And this is not to say the political will is not important. It obviously is. But it's a much harder, there are a lot of other questions to be asking and that are being asked, okay? It's very difficult to deter committed perpetrators. You know, we know that now. In some situations, the geopolitics of a particular situation, like Syria, make it very difficult to have traction on an issue. And lastly, I think there are operational challenges, like the kinds of things we've seen in Darfur and other places, that present themselves. I think the book, taking into consideration some of those findings, also makes a case for the need for a case-sensitive approach to try to understand every situation is going to be different, and given the situation, what is the realm of possibility? What is possible in terms of the mitigation or the prevention of mass atrocities? And I think makes the case that we should have some humility about what is possible. So I think it's important for those practitioners in the room or those who are advising practitioners to think through what is a realistic expectation for success? What is success in this field? How do we measure it? And I think, you know, on that point, for people who feel very beaten down by Syria, by South Sudan and others, I think it's also important to look back and point to places of relative success, Kenya, Kyrgyzstan, Myanmar, Guinea, Cote d'Ivoire, Mali, arguably Burundi. Again, we can have, I think, you know, spirited debates about whether or not we count any of those countries as successes. But I think it's worth having conversations about what it is that we count as a success and what is the realm of what might have happened and what did happen. A couple words on how to use this book, and then I'll speak to the question of the agenda going forward. I think, you know, this is a book that's meant to be, I'd love it if you read it cover to cover, but it's not a page turner per se, but it's meant to be something that you can dip in and out of. You can pull up a chapter on concepts, you can pull up a chapter on causes, you can pull up a chapter on prevention and so forth. It can be a reference tool, it's designed to be a reference tool, in terms of, what is R2P? What are the pillars of R2P? You know, what did in the American context, what did the Presidential Study Directive 10 say, et cetera? What's in the Rome Statute and so forth? It's not a field manual. It's not a how-to guide. It doesn't say when this happens and that happens, you do this. But it is designed to be practical and to, I think, shape a practical conversation between people who are in the field and people who are in headquarters, providing language, indicators, and so forth, I think that can be used in a practical sense. Okay. My final set of remarks is about sort of the discussion going forward, and I think some of you may be better placed than I to talk about this, but from where I sit, three points. One, there's no guarantee, as you I'm sure know, that what has been accomplished in the past 20 years is going to stay accomplished. And I think that this came out very well in the recent Secretary General's report on R2P. There are increasing divisions on the Security Council. And I think that the positions on R2P and mass atrocity prevention among a number of rising powers, their positions remain to be seen. I think there's a lot that could go in a couple different directions. There are the rise of new security threats, I think a more challenging international economic environment than from when a lot of the progress had been made in the late 90s and 2000s. And all of those things, both the security changes and the economic challenges, risk making atrocity prevention a more distant priority. As such, I think there remains a great deal of work to be done just to maintain, of course to develop, But probably there's going to be a fair amount of work just to maintain what the status quo is now. I mean, that remains to be seen, but I think that's a concern. Second, and I've already hinted at this, I would encourage practitioners in this area to engage in a spirited debate about those cases which are seen to undermine atrocity prevention and responsibility to protect more broadly. I have in mind here Libya, where I think one has to be critical and precise about what went wrong with the Libya. I also have in mind here in particular Syria. And the point is that while there are critical problems from an atrocity prevention point of view between, you know, you can expand it, but, you know, but particularly between Libya and Syria, I think it's important not to, you know, throw the baby out with the bathwater and to understand from an atrocity prevention what went wrong in these places and to be precise about that and to not lose sight of the places where atrocity prevention had traction. Kenya, some of the places I mentioned before. Even Colombia, and so forth. So in short, I think that Syria and Libya should not define the policy space on these questions. And lastly, I think that we have to recognize that while states continue to be key drivers of mass atrocity, there appears to be an increase in atrocities by non-state actors, and Adam mentioned this as well, and in particular by jihadist organizations. And I think the challenge here is how to balance or bring together an atrocity prevention agenda with a counterterrorism security agenda. And I think this has to be handled carefully. Obviously, it's very important to get buy-in from states. It's very important to have state interests in a particular policy space. But I think should the atrocity prevention be seen as equivalent to or in a Trojan horse for a security agenda, a counterterrorism agenda, I think that will ultimately undermine atrocity prevention in the long run. So I continue to hope that there is investment in this agenda from the Secretary General and from the specialized agencies and continue to get the funding they need, the institutionalization they need, continue to have an ear of member states and so forth. I think it's a tall agenda, but very much one to be continued. So thank you.
Great, thanks, Scott. It's very helpful to hear you listening. I mean, after having read the book, and I think it's absolutely right that it's proves the book is very helpful to be this one-stop shop. It's helpful to have this all-in-one book. And you mentioned that, you know, our conversation about that the field of atrocity prevention itself had been compartmentalized. But of course, we've been talking here in this room and elsewhere about how the UN system itself has been struggling for so long with these siloed approaches. And the need to bridge these silos, and I think that's very evident in the atrocity prevention field as well. That and the more we look into it, the more we understand the need for cooperation, bridging between the peace and security community, the human rights, sustainable development, the better off we'll be. And I think the book is helpful in that way. But at the same time, I think it's very important, that. As you state, that there has to be also a case-sensitive approach. While we have this one-stop shop book here, it is important to remain sensitive to local context. But of course, you know, every case is different, but some cases are more different than others. We don't have to start fresh, new each time. We have a body of literature. We have a body of experiences that we can learn from. It's important for us to recognize the progress and recognize what we've learned. So thank you very much for all that. Now I will turn the floor to Naomi for further comments.
Great, thank you very much, Adam, and thank you, Scott. I would just like to say the book is a page turner, and we have many copies of the book in the back, so I would urge you all to take one home. They make great presents. With that, it was good that Scott went first because he's going to, I think, inherently take a more optimistic outlook, although I am generally and will always remain a very strong supporter of kind of R2P and atrocity prevention. But I do find it deeply humbling to be here. And I think as a starting point, Scott kind of outlined the limits to what we know, the need for research, the need to align the remarkable work that's being done, not just by researchers, but also by practitioners in the field to help inform the policy choices and conversations that we have, to basically help to elevate the quality of those conversations and help inform our actions that we can act in a much earlier stage to help save lives. It's humbling also because we're here more than 70 years after the Holocaust talking about how to essentially give life to a principle that has been much kind of expressed around never again and the sentiments captured in this political framework around R2P. And I find myself, after having left New York in part because of frustration of engaging the Security Council for over 6 years on these types of crises and feeling as though it was political theater, leaving with a desire to go somewhere to be able to see how one government, and I agree completely with what Adam said around the fact that there's no one single government, no one single institution that can actually be the definitive actor that will prevent or halt an atrocity. But I was curious to see how one particular actor could help to strengthen a prevention agenda and act in an earlier stage. And one of the things that I think is a big takeaway is that the similarities and the challenges that exist at a national level within capitals is actually very similar to the challenges that the UN system faces. There's a real need to be able to define what a prevention agenda looks like, both at a national, regional, and international level. There's a need to build the space for the individuals who are going to try to advance that agenda. And there's a need to ensure that you engage your domestic stakeholders, or in the UN context, the UN officials that are on the ground that are seeing some of the risk factors and the atrocities unfold, and ensure that they have the tools at their disposal to actually save lives. And I find that a lot of the challenges are actually quite similar, and a lot of the impediments, I thought it was interesting when Scott mentioned the cases where we've seen success, and I've written about some of those cases too, there are a lot of similarities to a certain degree in them. And some of those similarities just come down to how key individual member states define the national interests that they have in a particular country vis-a-vis other interests that they might have. The focus of our center is very much on trying to do early warning and facilitate and encourage early action to create scenarios where we don't have to be engaging in the political theater that is at times the Security Council. And it's partly born out of the reality that we live in a situation where we've got ample norms that have been created to try to protect civilians, but we're seeing them on a daily basis being violated. And we're also facing a situation where those norms have been espoused internationally and local populations have bought into those norms. They believe that they will be protected, yet we're increasingly seeing a gulf emerge between what our stated principles are and the lived realities for people on the ground. And I think that's what has to compel us to take the work that Scott and other researchers are doing and Adam has been doing to try to better improve the type of policy that we're undertaking, but also to develop the tools, basic things like training at a starting point. Imagine as every single Foreign Service officer, diplomat here in this room across the street actually was trained in being able to identify the early warning signs of mass atrocities. It's not going to be a guarantee that we'll see more early action, but it's going to at least change the conversation. And I think to Scott's point, at least there's a conversation being had now. We have to be doing all we can to elevate the type of prioritization placed on civilian protection and on the aversion of mass atrocities so that when people come in with countervailing agendas, including counterterrorism, there is more of a frank conversation about the costs of those particular actions. One of the things when I kind of reflect on the challenges right now, the challenges that we're dealing with, and I think Scott alluded to, is that over the last 2 years, we've actually been confronted with a situation where some of the most conscious shocking of crimes have happened. I've traveled to Iraq twice in the past year, and we produced a report that basically documented the commission of genocide against the Yazidi population. Genocide is an incredibly rare occurrence. As a human rights lawyer who's focused on genocide, I never actually thought that I would be confronted with a situation where I had to go and document genocide. It is hard to comprehend that this crime has been allowed to happen, that we've been aware of it, and that today it continues to persist. There are 3,200 women and children that are still being held by the Islamic State and are the victims of genocide. What is interesting is that the experience with ISIS reveals quite a lot in terms of where the field of atrocity prevention needs to go. It informs the challenges that we face in terms of understanding the motivations of perpetrators, in understanding the way they work, how they receive their resources, which allow them to facilitate the commission of crimes. We've got limitations in terms of understanding how our tools, which are based much more on a state-centric system, can be used to tackle the commission of these crimes by these types of perpetrators. It also shows that we need to be able to muster the resolve, and I do think the political will part that Scott alluded to is a really important component here, because our perpetrators, those perpetrating crimes, often have a much higher resolve to commit crimes than those of us working at times to try to halt them. They're also very creative in trying to find new strategies to commit those atrocities, and we have to equally be innovative in our strategies that we employ as we move forward. But what I think is also interesting about the case of the most recent commission of genocide is that despite having these norms in existence, despite the genocide convention existing, and one of the clearest obligations in that being the obligation to prosecute and hold those accountable, 2 years after the commission of genocide by ISIS, we still have mass graves lying undocumented, unprotected. We haven't seen significant inroads made even on some of the things that one considered to be the lowest hanging fruit. If we're not succeeding on the prevention and the halting, although there were, I think, commendable steps taken on the halting, we aren't actually kind of advancing very much on the effort to actually hold perpetrators to account at times as well in a more immediate sense. And I think that that's something that we have to really kind of grapple with. Because what's so remarkable about, for example, ISIS is this is actually a perpetrator of which, if we were to cross the street and talk to the Security Council members, they've been pretty much near unanimity in the fact that they oppose ISIS. There's no kind of state that is supporting them in an overt way in this commission. Yet we're still finding that we're lagging behind in terms of that particular response. Which brings me to the need to really focus in terms of a future challenge, both for capitals and here for the UN system, on the need to really develop a prevention agenda. With the kind of pillar one and pillar two, the responsibility to protect, there is consensus around those two components of the norm. And I think what we need to be doing is increasingly focusing on where there is common ground and how we can actually establish clear benchmarks that states can take forward where there is consensus. And when we talk about kind of a prevention agenda, the prevention agenda is both for those states that are at risk of atrocities, better defining what they can do to respond to those risks, but it's also very much about the states that are responders, neighbors and others that are going to play a role in helping at an early stage to avert the atrocities. And for that to happen, that goes back to kind of the point that I was making earlier about there needing to be a clear prevention agenda, the space created for those who are going to help to take forward that agenda, but also resources allocated. And that's something that I have found interesting just in Washington, watching the role of Congress, for example, in creating an enabling environment. There is much that can be done by bureaucrats and by political actors that have been appointed and by the existing structures. But as we've seen, not just in terms of trying to get larger budgets allocated to preventive engagement, of which our elected officials, irrespective of which I'm Canadian, you know, it often is kind of the appropriations process in any particular government, in part goes through your parliamentary or system or congressional system. But it also creates the political legitimacy to prioritize early action and a greater focus on prevention. And I think that's where we tend to fall down quite a bit. And in doing that, I think there is a real need, based on numerous conversations with colleagues from different member states, but also in the US context, to do a better job of making the case for prevention, in trying to help to explain how prevention not just saves lives, but also does a whole host of other things. And I mean, this is going to sound very callous, but to a certain degree, it actually comes down to the dollars and cents. And that at times is what, unfortunately, has more sway than discussing the moral obligation to save lives. I'm just going to quickly touch on the role of the next Secretary General. And in that regard, I want to highlight a report that we recently released and which was authored by my wonderful colleagues, Lawrence Wisher, Dan Solomon, and also by Richard Gowan. And essentially, it's on preventing mass atrocities as an agenda for the next UN Secretary General. It's available online, and I highly recommend that you read it and disseminate it. The report is conscious of the role of the Secretary General and just how much the Secretary General can achieve. But it's also clear in stating, given the immense challenges that exist right now for the UN system, for the international community, this is going to be a Secretary General that will have to, at the forefront of their agenda, put preventing mass atrocity crimes and responding to mass atrocity crimes. And to do that, they're going to have to continue to move forward the initiative that has been taken forward by the current Secretary General around human rights up front and trying to change the cultural orientation of the entire UN system. We have a couple of concrete recommendations in there, including things such as even just convening at a very early stage in his tenure, town hall to explain why the UN system must at its core put a priority on atrocity prevention. But it also discusses in the report ways to improve the early warning analysis of the UN system, strengthen the Office of the Special Advisor on the Prevention of Genocide and the Responsibly Protect, and acknowledge the new Special Advisor for the Responsibly Protect who's here. It is going to be imperative that in the future that office continue to play an important role in helping to define what a prevention agenda looks like for the UN system and for member states. And one of the recommendations that we do put forward in the report is for the merging of the two positions to create potentially a stronger office and a stronger voice. It's also going to be really important for the Security Council, for the Secretary General to develop an effective way of communicating with the Security Council to fulfill his Article 99 obligations to tell the Council not what it wants to hear, but what it needs to hear, and to find innovative ways to be able to do that. I think I will conclude with that, maybe just with one kind of thought, again, having moved from the New York environment to a capital working on this. If our focus around atrocity prevention is on the Security Council, we have a doomed endeavor to a certain degree. There is much that the Council can do and should do, and there are remarkable avenues for getting more information to the Council that have been dropped, things like horizon scannings or discussions of issues that are potentially going to be before the Council and the Council should be engaging earlier at. But the reality is right now we have a Council that remains very much blocked. And we have a Council that also fails to see the synergies between its responses in the past to things like the Ukraine and creating a more permissive environment now for violations of international norm on Syria. And I think what we have to realize is that for all of us to not in 10, 20, or 30 years be talking about future genocides here, the priority in the next few years has to be in defining what a prevention agenda looks like and bringing the conversation about atrocity prevention to the capitals and having it informed by the local realities of populations on the ground and developing strategies based on the remarkable research of some of the people here on this panel and elsewhere in order to better save lives. So thank you.
Great, thank you. There's so much on the table here to discuss. I mean, I think your point or plea that it comes down to this tremendous gulf between our principles and realities on the ground. That we have now made quite a bit of progress on the norms. We have ample norms, but they're too often violated. Is very important, and the question is how do we narrow that gulf? In the UN circles, we've been talking also in terms of the protection of civilians and peacekeeping, the gap between expectations and capabilities. We're given mandates, mandates are given to protect civilians, but yet we're not given the tools to actually do it. How do we narrow that gap? And I think this call for that there really is a need for a clear prevention agenda that can work to create that political space to align interests so that it doesn't, the political cost is not to act, right? Mm-hmm. That it costs to not to act, not to it should be more automatic to do something, to make the case that it is in member states' collective interest and interest of the system itself to take action for prevention. So thank you. We've got a lot of questions, proposals on the table. So we have a good amount of time for Q&A. So we'll do a round of questions and then come back to the panel. Yes, Mr. Special Advisor will go first.
Thank you very much. And I thank Holocaust Museum and Simon Scott Center for producing a very thought-provoking publication. I thank IPI for organizing a highly timely event. We have selected Secretary General a couple of hours ago, and it's a great opportunity to discuss suggestions on what he should do to strengthen prevention of atrocity crimes. And of course, Professor Strauss, thank you very much for sharing main ideas of your book. I'll enjoy reading it, and I'm not fishing for the free copy. I would like to stress 3 points. The first one is atrocity crimes are once again in the rise. After the period of early 90s, we were having a positive trend. We don't have that positive trend anymore. We are facing not only war crimes, they are widespread and systematic, making them crimes against humanity. And as Naomi mentioned, genocide is not entirely off the table as well. My second point is that I entirely agree with all of you stressing the importance of prevention. There were recently three big UN review efforts. One is peacekeeping, the other one is peace building, and third one is women, peace, and security. And if they have something in common, it is a message that we need a shift towards prevention. And this probably is going to be an extreme challenge for new Secretary General, because that implies cultural change, institutional and operational change. And of course, the Secretary General cannot do that without civil society, without academia, without member states, and without United Nations staff. And let me, as a third point, mention that as new mandate holder for responsibility to protect, I intend to be part of that change. I will perceive my mandate not only in sense of academic activities in the R2P area, but operational as well. So again, thank you very much, dear panelists, and I'm looking forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, right here in the third row. And please introduce yourself for the webcast, please.
Susan Gittleson. Thank you so much for all your analytical work and for your concerns. Could you please, especially Professor Strauss, amplify on two examples, one where you've had real success, where there has been success based on past experiences, and the other is on failure and what has really been lacking and what might have been done, what might still be done.
Great, thank you. We could take one more before we go to back. Yes, here, please.
Manik Mehta, journalist. I come to the mass atrocities in Syria, looking at it from hindsight. In your view, what could have been done to prevent that? There are many factors I know, but could you identify a couple? Thank you.
Okay, I think we could maybe respond to those. I mean, the case of success and failure, and of course, just the small question about what to do about Syria.
Okay. So, you know, some of my examples, my own expertise regionally is more in sub-Saharan Africa, so some of the cases I know better. But I think you can see success in Kenya, both the most recent elections and also the previous elections, the ones that escalated quite rapidly. And I think the success in the first episode, which got worse than many people thought it would, I think had to do with a number of factors. It had to do with leadership from within the UN, I think it had to do with leadership from within the region to a degree, significant diplomatic pressure from key donors, but also civil society within Kenya, a kind of certain economic structure that supported a kind of mitigation and moderation of violence and so forth. Then you have a period between the elections in Kenya where you had a lot of conversation in that country about, mm-hmm. you know, the Constitution, about ethnic groups, about leadership, about corruption, about land and land rights and so forth. And again, there are problems with, you know, along the way. I'm not saying this is a perfect process. But I think that when you got to an election, which was a different election, but when you got to an election in 2013, I think the outcome was basically nonviolent. I mean, there was some violence, but it was relatively low. I think that I'm going to go in ascending order of controversial claims. I think that Côte d'Ivoire, I think, is also a success. And again, there are some domestic reasons why that particular war did not escalate into genocide, and I would stress those domestic dynamics as well. But you also saw, I think, a pretty strong regional and international position on the situation in Côte d'Ivoire, on the outcome of the elections, and on the questions of atrocities that made the escalation, that constrained the escalation of that violence. And I also think that was also partially a success. The most controversial statement I would make is that I think Burundi, and here I want to say one has to think about these cases about what the potential for mass atrocities are and what the reality is. The potential in Burundi is massive, given its history, given what's going on in that country today. And the violence has been relatively limited to date. I could be, you know, next week or 2 weeks from now or a month or a year from now, I could be completely wrong. I think that has to do from a certain amount of engagement. That's part of it. And I think it also has to do with domestic factors. It has to do with what happened in civil society in Burundi. I think it has to do with a long process of discussion and a set of choices that people made, the political actors made in Burundi over time, prior to the current crisis. So whether you call that a success or not, I mean, it's a weird success. It's not a success in a broad sense, but from an atrocity prevention point of view, I think there are things there to pay attention to, is the point. I mean, Syria is a huge failure, and that can perhaps come to the second, you know, is a huge failure. So is Iraq in some ways. I think one has to recognize how difficult the Syria situation is politically, geostrategically. That has to do with the dynamics of the Middle East, that has to do with Russia, Turkey, the whole, you know, complex Middle East politics between some of the Gulf states, some of the non-Gulf states, et cetera, and the United States and Israel. And so I think Syria, you know, is a failure for a number of reasons. Why did it get to this stage? I mean, I think Lawrence and others at the museum have a project on this, and maybe they'd want to speak to that. I don't know what the status of that research is. He smiles. But obviously, there were a number of missed opportunities in the early going of that crisis. I mean, that's not that revolutionary to say, in the sense that you had a period of time prior to the outbreak of civil war, or at the early stages of the civil war, when the domestic opposition. Right, and the other complication with Syria is just, you know, the armed opposition. You have to think about what the consequences of any kind of action in Syria would be, you know. And one of the, you know, and that's part of the you know, I mentioned all the international rivalries, but you also have the domestic question of, you know, there's ISIS, and you know, you significantly constrain the military apparatus of the Syrian state. If you were to go that direction, the most likely beneficiary of that is probably going to be ISIS. That's a huge problem. So we're at a stage today where it's not hard to explain why there is paralysis on Syria. I think the opportunity was in the early stages. It was the first 18 months of that crisis, when I think people were in the shadow of Libya, in the shadow of Egypt, and you know, and also the, you know, and I think cognizant of the Russian strategic concerns in that country, which made it harder to generate a more forceful atrocity prevention agenda in Syria. you know, then if you look back, I mean, the case that I know the best would be the Rwandan genocide, which was, you know, a different era of failure. But it's instructive to look back at that era from the 1990s, when during the early stages of that genocide, we can be mad and frustrated about what's going on in like places like Iraq and Syria today, and we're well aware of the shortcomings. But in Rwanda at the time, there was not much of a conversation about what the policy was going to be. The policy was get out. from an international perspective. It was hamstring the UN operation. And so I think it's important to look back at some of those cases. As frustrated as we are today, I mean, that's, you know, and maybe you think I'm just in an ivory tower, but I think that that is, I still think it's, you know, there was no conversation.
I'll just add a couple of quick points to the, just on kind of recent cases. I think there'd be two or three things that I would say. One echoes a finding that's in the Secretary General's report on the importance of regional offices of the UN. I think when we look at Cote d'Ivoire and Guinea, for example, and the response to the Sahel, one really important standout has been the role of the UN's West Africa office, including previously under the leadership of Zaid Jinnat, the individual role that he played to help facilitate kind of a more peaceful resolution to crises that were there. And I think it speaks to a need to strengthen those tools that already exist within the UN kind of arena, like those regional offices. And there's also one that in the Kyrgyzstan crisis played a role as well. I think a second factor is the need to really align domestic, regional, and international efforts more effectively and greater coordination with each other, which is a very big challenge to do. But I think in Guinea in particular, that was an important kind of contributing factor, but that you see the international community remain engaged in a sustained and concerted way. The idea that flashpoints are just flashpoints and a year later the situation will be much better, I think is a very artificial discourse. And the same, and I think this kind of gets to some of the concerns around Libya, that one can kind of go in with these type of pinprick responses and then pull out and the situation will be stabilized. I think there needs to be a lot more research and analytical thought about testing some of those particular assumptions and making a compelling argument for sustained engagement. A third is really just the important role that local actors play. I think often we focus on the international community's response and downplay the significant role that local communities as advocates for their own well-being play, not just in helping to mediate conflict, not just in finding creative solutions. In Kenya, the local business community came up with a number of solutions from SMS test messages that said one people, one nation, one peace, something along those lines. In Guinea, there were peace marches and dialogues that happen throughout the country, but also even as actors who are providing for their own civilian protection in these particular situations. And Syria today is one example where you see courageous doctors protecting populations in hospitals built underground, where you see attempts to create early warning tools so that people can have at least a 30-second notice that there's going to be an aerial bombardment. Those are innovative strategies that have been developed by local communities, and what we can do to empower them and more accurately understand the role that local communities play in improving the efficacy, perhaps, of the international community's response or the regional community's response, I think is really important, because it will also help build that case for why prevention is important and why supporting local actors in doing so is important. Very quickly, just on Syria, we do have a project that will be launched, which will look at kind of, I actually won't speak to it too much because I know I will not do justice to Lawrence and Dan's work on that, but it is going to be forthcoming, and we will share the information with IPI and others on the kind of outcomes. I will say, having been involved along with Kate and others in the room on engaging on Syria more from an advocacy perspective, I remember in the first week, the second week, when the young children had gone to take into the streets to protest, meeting with Security Council ambassadors, and doing so for 3 years after that. And I would say that I would just kind of compliment Scott's points on perhaps gaps in the first year. They have to do with kind of understanding the situation and analysis. And I think one very large point for me that is not just unique to Syria, but I think has been a factor in most of the cases that I've worked on, we tend to hope for the best and we don't necessarily plan for the worst. How many meetings I had with people, really well-informed council ambassadors, who said, no, but Assad is an ophthalmologist trained in London. How many times I literally had to say he might be an ophthalmologist trained in London, but that doesn't mean he's incapable of committing atrocities. I went to Oxford. I really think some of my classmates could very well become perpetrators in the future. We really do not know what's possible. They're really wonderful. But I'm just saying, like, you need to kind of be able to be frank and to put yourself in the perspective of perhaps these individuals to understand their motivations and rationale and to recognize that what we deem as rational is not necessarily what they're going to deem as rational in their particular spot. And I think that was a challenge in theory of the early stages. I also think that we lost very early on the debate over the discourse of were they civilians or were they terrorists, the point that was made before about the counterterrorism agenda. Same phenomenon has happened in Sri Lanka. Talking to council members about Sri Lanka back in, what was it, 2009, I was amazed how many council members had been fighting a war on terror domestically. Everyone from the UK to the Turks had a language of terrorism that they were familiar with. And I do think, unfortunately, at the early stages during that first year, there wasn't a sufficient push to retain the narrative that these were innocent civilians that were being targeted. And then the last was that rhetoric matters. And I think this is something where I hope that there is research being undertaken and will continue about when rhetoric can open or close avenues for preventive diplomacy. And I think that we have to understand Syria in the first year of Syria in the context of what was happening and unfolding in Libya, in the context of having IBSA council members very opposed to what had happened in Libya, and to understand it in that context, I think raises more questions about the use of language from a very early stage about Assad has to go and things along those lines, and what that did in terms of maybe shrinking the space for certain forms of preventive diplomacy. I don't know if an envoy should have been appointed within the first 2 or 3 months, but it is striking that it took a year for that to happen. So I can't speak to what were the warning signs beforehand. It does strike me, though, that there were some missed opportunities in the first year. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Yes, so I'll have another round. Yes, Kate, too.
Thank you so much. And Nicole, your revelations about your own experience here and what you've learned from it give us a lot to digest after this is over. I'm the UN representative for CARE International, 16 years now, and so have been through a lot of protection of civilian debates. I'm very keen to read your book and very excited that you've created a one-stop shop. The question I'd like to refer to is the calling on civil society, the references to civil society, which we have also learned over these 20 years how important local actors are. I'd like to focus specifically on women in the local settings who also have emerged finally as not only victims of violence but potential participants in prevention and response. Short of having read your book yet, did you come across that element, the element of gender and women's participation, and did you focus on it in the book? If not, have you got some thoughts on it? Thank you.
Great, thanks. And here in the third row here, I think, no? Did you?
Hi, my name is Tanya Bernath. I just had a question. Earlier, Professor Strauss mentioned that there was a success in Myanmar, and I just wanted to hear a little bit more about that with regard to the Rohingya. And, you know, maybe some ideas about prevention strategies there, considering that it's a population that doesn't have any support locally. Mm-hmm. And just to talk more through that. Thanks.
Okay. We'll go over here to this gentleman here on the left, and then over to the right. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm coming from a country which has been victim of violent atrocities frequently, India. So we feel the pinch, we feel the pain. But I'm very happy that this sort of dialogue will take to higher elevation. Now, one or two things I wanted to emphasize. I am coming from a university called Amity Education Group. In India, we have 1,25,000 students. The youth have to be tackled. And for that, education is the most important. And I did not see much emphasis on education. The academic impact is more devastating in getting positive results than violent activities. And for that, we have to reach out to the youth everywhere. India is a country where 65% of the population are less than 30. That is the market for you. And I'm very glad that you have analyzed, institutionalized, and I thought one more I should be added. Investigate why violent activities are taking. Once we know that, we'll be able to find a solution. I think this sort of gathering is starting. I have only one small suggestion. Instead of saying why we fail a negative approach, I thought we could say why we are less successful. The attitude elevates your altitude. In that sense, I think it's a good job. My friend Ramu is here, and so many scholarly. I liked the presentation by the two scholarly speakers. I think we are right at the solution point. I'm very happy. Thank you very much. I'm from Professor Sitaraman is my name.
Great, thank you. Do you mind if we keep collecting? Is that, I think,
Thank you. Gay Rosenblum Kumar. I'm a consultant with the Swiss Task Force on Dealing with the Past. And I'd like to ask you about how to transform the improved discourse into real concrete action on the ground. And particularly if I may share some examples of partnerships that are doing that, and then ask you about the potential for those partnerships to do more. And as Naomi said, to really get this into capitals and broadly. So I'd like to mention the a relatively new initiative, a state-led and state civil society partnership called Global Action Against Mass Atrocity Crimes, with a rather awkward acronym of GAMAC, which you can find at www.gamac.org. Which is just a few years old and held its second international meeting with more than 50 states in Manila in February. Now, this is a network led by five states and about five NGOs that are really looking to demystify and destigmatize atrocity prevention and make it part of a regular discourse by implying that it can happen everywhere, and all countries, like Denmark and Switzerland, which are partners, are developing their own internal national atrocity prevention agenda. And so what I'd like to ask you is if you see the ways that they are doing this through GAMAC and other of the very good NGOs like Auschwitz Institute and GCR2P, who have a national focal point network, and the Latin American Network for Atrocity Prevention, by doing things like sharing experiences country to country, or getting NGOs to impart their expertise to member states in ways where they have not in the past been on an equal platform. And also trying to mainstream this. I know that's an overused word, but not just having the diplomats or the Foreign Service get this kind of training, but recognizing that it has to be a whole of government approach, including the humanitarians, the development workers, the peace builders, through things like, of course, exchange of information, but developing the real national institutions, or what we call the national infrastructure for prevention, like the mediation centers, the early warning centers. And I'd like to ask you what the potential for partnership is and how you see this expanding. Thanks.
Great, thanks. At the risk of putting too much on the table, I know our social media officer back there has her hand up, and so we get some questions from Twitter or Facebook, and I think if we could just get that on the table, then we'll come back to the panel.
I apologize, Adam. This question is actually on behalf of myself today. So I actually have a master's in international history, and I wrote my dissertation on the foundation of the United Nations War Crimes Commission during World War II. And I see some parallels from today, so I'd love to get your thoughts. Specifically, what I was looking at was an idea for an international criminal court that was proposed by the Allies during the war. And this archive was opened in 2012, and I went to The Hague and read these documents. And there was a lot of evidence that was collected that never saw its day in court. For instance, the fascist war crimes in Ethiopia, because the court was not established, because the politics changed so dramatically after the war. It was a British-French idea. The Americans preferred a military trial. So I wonder today what you think about, you mentioned that you've been collecting evidence about the atrocities with ISIS. How do we ensure that countries who've built these cases get their day in court now that we have the court? And what do you think continues to be a challenge by US opposition, which continues today?
Great, thanks. A lot of questions on the table. Thank you for that. I think we'll go in reverse order. Naomi, maybe you'll speak, and then we'll give Scott, you can have the last word. Yeah?
Sounds good.
Sorry.
Okay. I'll try to quickly answer some of the questions or just also provide some thoughts. Very briefly, just on Myanmar, we released a report last year where we highlighted the risk of genocide towards the Rohingya, and we have been working to try to continue to draw attention to the unique threats that they face. A colleague has recently returned and will be releasing a new report, which will try to unpack more chains of command and also recommendations for states and for the UN system to take forward, which I think is particularly important given that we're at a moment right now where there has been transition and where a lot of people feel that that means that inevitably the situation for the Rohingya will improve, and we actually haven't seen that correlation. So I just wanted to highlight that that will be forthcoming. I just wanted to thank the, I love the idea of the reframing, which I think is so important for those of us who've been working on these issues, and I do like the idea to say that we, it's not that we failed, we've just been less successful. I think I'm gonna leave the comment to Scott in regards to engaging students, but I think it's a very important point to make about the role that the next generation plays in helping to set an agenda to help prevent atrocities in countries, including in India, but also in creating a culture whereby people feel that they have a civic responsibility to help others. That basic principle of I am my brother or sister's keeper is something that is a universal concept. It need not be kind of a religious concept. It's one that I think informs many of the norms that we are talking about and that underpin the UN system. Gay, thank you for raising the various kind of mechanisms that exist. And there are a number that have been created to try to help create a forum for governments to discuss how they can begin to be comfortable with the responsibility to protect and with genocide prevention, and for others also to discuss how they can actually start taking concrete steps to operationalize it. And I think it's similar to what I said earlier about the need to develop a prevention agenda and create space for champions to emerge, essentially. And I think that's what those forums allow for. I think the challenge is how to, each of those configurations have got states that have varying levels of comfort with the existing norms and have got varying levels of capacity. So how do you continue to create a safe space for people to discuss and develop a common agenda, while also for those states that have the capacity to be able to fast track? I do not understand why today we still only have really kind of one government that has made a clear, overt political statement saying the prevention of atrocities is a national security priority. That's the United States. That's something that many governments could do. And there could be a more concerted effort to try to allocate political resources and economic resources to defining what a national plan looks like. The Auschwitz Institute for Peace and Reconciliation has been trying to do that at a regional level within Latin America, and has been working in a concerted way with governments to develop national action plans. It is a slow process, but it's taking hold, and I think that's something that we can try to replicate with others. But I do think that that's going to be an important task of the Special Advisor's Office, of the new Secretary General, to help define what the parameters of that looks like. I think the gap that still remains is we don't have a track to community in a robust manner that I think we need, of civil society, academics working together to get out of the silos, to ensure that we are engaging governments in capitals, putting pressure there. And I think that part of the challenge for the next 10 years of R2P is to essentially build that community, so that it's not just member states that are driving the conversations or organizations based in New York with a couple outposts and capitals, but really a more global conversation. Finally, on the court, and on, I'm going to maybe just stick to the issue of kind of the Yazidis in particular, because I think it is an interesting one. There's almost a kind of starting point that needs to happen, and that is for there to be an independent international investigation into the crimes that ISIS actually committed. And because justice can take a very long time to be served in a formal sense, a starting point is to actually ensure that there is entities that have got the investigatory capacity to be on the ground collecting evidence, analyzing it, and preserving it for not just future prosecutions, but also just for the purpose of truth-telling, helping families understand whether or not their loved ones were killed or missing or what happened to them, and for reconciliation. But on the accountability side, in a more formal sense, that evidence can be used for cases at the local, kind of regional or international level. At the local level, theoretically, the government in Baghdad has the capacity to try these cases. Whether or not they have the political will to, or whether or not the Kurdish regional government in Erbil has the political will to, is the real question. neither has the actual legislation that allows for them to carry cases out on genocide or crimes against humanity, and that's a pretty large deficit. They also have to cooperate with each other, because what many people tend to forget is that these crimes were committed in a part of Iraq that is contested territory between those two. So you need to have cooperation by both, which is why this investigation would likely have to be mandated by the Security Council and be similar to something like the Hariri investigation in a slightly different sense. If those cases don't happen, or if there are serious questions, which I think is a very plausible scenario, where the Iraqi government or the Kurdish regional government don't prosecute, or where there's questions about their impartiality, there could be potentially a hybrid mechanism created with the help of the international community, or cases could be brought to the International Criminal Court. I think the challenge with bringing a case like this to the International Court, it goes a little bit back to that issue that I raised before about public expectations. The ICC, if it was to hear cases regarding ISIS, will only be able to deal with cases that are really the kind of upper echelon of commanders. And the challenges that arise then is many people will likely be killed. Many potentially will kill themselves. It's unclear whether or not we're going to be able to see cases brought at that level. I think there's a second issue which is important from the local perspective, which is that though we talk about this conflict, and though we fixate quite a bit on the role of foreign fighters, this is very much a local conflict. The perpetrators were local for the most part. They were Iraqis. They were in some cases Syrians. When I spoke to survivors of this, they talk about the need to ensure that their neighbor, and I'm curious, you know, Scott's experiences in Rwanda, they talk about their neighbors turning on them, being able to identify by name the person who stole their mother or killed their brother. They want to see justice at the local level. Those individuals are never going to be prosecuted by the ICC. So while it's important to talk about the ICC and it's important to talk about setting expectations, we have to recognize that justice has to be local in this particular case too, if it's going to do anything in terms of preventing a recurrence of atrocities. So I'm not going to get too much onto the US position, other than to say I do find it as a non-American fascinating that they actually continue to be large supporters of the court, including from a funding perspective. So it's a bit of a contradiction in the position.
Great, thank you.
I've been trying to think of whether or not I could synthesize all the questions into one coherent response, and the answer is no. So I will take them quickly in order. I think civil society is hugely important, both domestic, you know, national groups, local groups, international groups, transnational groups. I mean, partly for setting the agenda, but also for concrete work in a particular place. I underline that in the book. I also draw attention to tensions between communities within civil society. We think of civil society as a unitary actor, but there often are tensions, different agendas, and it's important not just to gloss those tensions. They can often be an obstacle. With regard specifically to women, it wasn't a focus in the book, but I think you're right to draw attention to it. And I think what we've learned about post-conflict environments in particular is that it creates a space for groups that previously had been marginalized to come to the table in a different way and have a voice. And the war, often the wars themselves or the atrocities, you know, spark a certain kind of interest and political engagement counterintuitively, right? Civic participation is greater after war. What I would steer you to is a book recently written by my colleague Eileen Tripp about women in post-conflict peace building, which I can give you the reference afterwards. But it's a great question, and I think deserves more attention. Myanmar, I don't want to say this is a success as such, but I think the point I was trying to make is that we've been warning, people in the international community have been warning about genocide in Myanmar for a long time. And I think that what we have seen is a certain amount of engagement at a high diplomatic level with the leaders in Myanmar about those risks and about what the potential consequences would be. Now, whether or not that has shaped the response and has been a certain constraint on their action, I don't know. I don't know a lot of the details about Myanmar, but from where I sit, the potential for much greater violence is there, and it hasn't exploded in that way. So With regard to, and that was the reference I was making, with regard to education, I mean, obviously I agree, I'm an educator. This book, by the way, is freely available. It can be downloaded on the internet from the museum site, and it's meant to reach people, ideally, in, you know, all over the world, so they can have a quick and free access to the material. You know, students continue, in my experience, students are really engaged by these topics, so, you know, I think that it's important to recognize there is a, at least in my experience, there's a well of enthusiasm and interest and engagement around these issues, which I find really inspiring. And so I do think it's important, and I think you're absolutely right, the next generation, you know, this is going to be the next generation's issue. And so I think education is fundamental. I think the last two questions were in a way of, I mean, I'd like to learn more about Gamak, and thank you for the reference. I think, you know, to echo Naomi's point, you know, national institutions are incredibly important. And the question is whether or not, and I think what we have to recognize is that there are domestic politics around these issues, and that it's important to understand those domestic politics. And so the creation of an institution in and of itself is not going to necessarily make a difference. It's going to be understanding, I think, having an analysis, a kind of case-sensitive analysis of what the politics of memory are, what the politics of atrocity prevention are, and what the realm of action might be in a particular country. I mean, I look forward to learning more. I mean, lastly, on the ICC, I think that, you know, the ICC needs, I think we've become very painfully aware of the limits of the ICC over the last decade. And I think that the ICC has evolved into a fairly vulnerable position, not that it's not going to continue, but as an institution for atrocity prevention, I think it's trying to adapt to the environment that it's in, the political environment that it's in. So whether or not there's a parallel there to World War II is a good question. But I think the ICC, for reasons that are understandable, has become often gets trapped by domestic politics. And I think that that's a real constraint, because it needs the cooperation of states. And states have interests in why they cooperate or don't. And the minute you get into that kind of negotiation, the ICC ends up leaning on certain cases and not leaning on other cases. And I think that has created a certain unevenness in its approach. And so I think that's, you know, that remains a constraint for the ICC. So anyway.
Yeah, absolutely.
I just wanted to add maybe two things that both the question and the kind of response made me think about. And it's more one, I think, which is kind of, I'm curious on where the research is or where it would go. One is like how we understand violence too, right? Okay. Especially when we think about the commission of mass atrocities, because if you, from a legal perspective, look at crimes against humanity, for example, or genocide, there are elements within those where we wouldn't overtly see large-scale loss of life, yet you have the commission of atrocities taking place. So, you know, an apartheid-type situation. In Iraq, the prevention of births of children. One could argue, kind of in Burma, you've got ethnic cleansing or the creation of conditions that just, we used kind of in early stages years ago from an R2P perspective working on a country like Burma, this notion of a slow burn, which people have talked about at times in other countries as well. So I'm curious about what that term violence means in the context of atrocity prevention. And the second thing was, it made me also think just about something tangentially related, but since we were talking about Kenya before, the unintended consequences of some of the tools that we use. So when I was in Kenya during the last election, there was a lot of discussion about the need for peace and peace at all costs. I remember a number of Kenyan advocates, human rights advocates, we're saying, you know, can we say that peace is necessarily the outcome that we should be advocating for if peace comes at the cost of silencing dissent or viable concerns about the way in which the election was held? And so I'm just curious almost from the international community's perspective, how those definitions kind of influence our understandings of the tools that we have and the situations and crises in which we should be responding. And that might just be a question for everyone, but I mean, it's something I'm
wrestling with. Yeah, one last response. It's a huge topic.
I mean, no, I mean, there's an academic response to what is violence, which is, you know, the deliberate infliction of harm, which can encompass a wide range of violence, including, you know, sexual violence or prevention of birth or whatever. I think for the atrocity prevention agenda to continue to have traction, I think one has to preserve a certain level or a sense of massness or systematicness to what is being prevented. There's a lot of violence in the world. There's a lot of violence, you know, in our country. and so I think that it's important. I think the risk of R2P, or one of the risks, is that it's, you know, there's crimes against humanity, there's war crimes, there's genocide and ethnic cleansing for some. That's actually a huge scope of action. And it makes sense to have a huge scope, but I think for a more, you know, you're talking about having a clear prevention strategy and policy, I think it's important to put some boundaries on what that means, you know, is what I would say. You know, in the book, just to come back to the book, I do think it's important to underline what some of the, in addition to what we don't know, what are some of the negative consequences of action. So I think that's more clear on coercive or on the more coercive spectrum side of things, certainly military sanctions. Your point about peace, I think, is a good one. But I think that I think one that has to be part of the analysis. And I think historically it has been. What are the potential negative consequences to what we do? And I think that's a really important point.
Great, thank you. This has been a really rich discussion. I really, really appreciate it. I just came from a conference in Reykjavik where I had a conversation with a Russian colleague from a think tank in Moscow, and I was telling him a bit about this upcoming event and my work on atrocity prevention. And he said, "Oh well, you know, after Libya, R2P is dead." And I think there's actually there are some people who have that view, and I think this sort of discussion and delving into the details of atrocity prevention work out there shows that this field is very alive and necessary. And I think it also reiterates the point a bit that, as Scott made, that we shouldn't allow the Syria and Libya cases to define the policy space when we discuss these issues. And in particular, I think one of the conversations, aspects of this conversation that highlights for me is that we're at risk of just focusing on what's happening across the street and at the international level, when so much is happening at the local level, so much is important at the domestic and the national level, including civil society and issues around education and youth. And I think that's for me anyway, an important takeaway of this discussion, which I really appreciate it. So thank you. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.